Hey, good evening, Stonegate. Let me pray over you as we begin our evening. Father, thank you for a beautiful day for us to draw breath in. Thank you for the opportunity to be together in this place under the banner of Jesus Christ. Pray that you would help us to just step away from distraction and just so much going on in our lives and just allow us to just bathe in your presence tonight, to respond to the one that made us with praise, an act of worship. Father, we love you and we thank you so much for this opportunity to gather together and sing of your goodness and your mercy and your love that is transforming us and our salvation through Jesus Christ. We love you and we praise you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, let's stand and let's sing this together. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! Then sings my soul, my Savior God. How great thou art, how great thou art. So turn your ear to heaven and hear the noise inside. We say. sing Come Thou Fount.
Come Thou Fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing Thy praise. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious song, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming.
Thank you for just great lyrics for us to sing to you. Thank you for just great music from before our generations, Father, that has come through in just a strong statements of who you are, strong statements of our life in you. Thank you for the opportunity we have to sing of your grace and to be real in our lives, Father, as we pursue you, pursue this life in you. Thank you, Father. We love Father, I believe we could just rest and just kind of marinate in that whole thought of you being, you are holy. And I pray that we'd find a peace in that, knowing that you are holy, you are Lord over it all. If we can just be in this place of awe with you, I believe with that awe comes peace. Just trusting you in wherever you have us, trusting you in whatever you're taking us through, however you're growing and changing us. And we just see a glimpse of how big and awesome you are. We should be humbled before you and just be struck with awe. Father, you are holy. You are worthy to be praised. I pray that our offering of praise tonight has been just honest and sincere before you. It's been sweet to you as we've offered ourselves in praise. Thank you how you renew us through that. What is supposed to be our offering to you of praise, and through that you renew us. We are refreshed in that. Thank you. And Father, just as that is an act of worship, our praise, our service to each other, we give a tithe and offering each week here as an opportunity for us to respond to you in worship, just as we do in any other act of worship in our lives. An opportunity for us to submit to you in this and just be obedient. And I pray we'd honor you in this. We thank you, Father, for your love and your mercy. Thank you for our salvation through Jesus Christ. It's in his name we come to you and we praise you tonight. Amen. And please be seated.
All right, well, good job. Once again, I've said it in every service. I just want to say how awesome it is to see Blake up here leading. I don't know if Blake just graduated from high school last year, and he's been with us for a long time, I think since Quest 56 at least. I mean, we've watched him grow up, and we tease him for being Jack Black's lookalike, but you know, whatever it takes to be famous, right? So, is everybody else's bracket now shot now that Kansas got beat? Go Virginia Commonwealth. The rest of you are like, I still don't care. So,
do you have any idea what he's talking about?
No.
Okay.
Did either one of you do a bracket?
I honestly still don't really know what that means.
I think it's something you do in a math formula.
All I know is that everybody's is shot.
Yeah,
that's all I've heard.
It is. No number ones left? I mean, what in the world? I just wonder, did anybody pick Virginia Commonwealth to even make after the entry game? Anyway, admit it. Did you really? Did you seriously did? Did you have any clue what you were doing? You're just like, I like the name. What? On what basis would you say Virginia Commonwealth? Did you go there? What was your, tell us.
Because it's a neat name.
That would mean she didn't choose A&M, right? What'd she say? I know, you're smarter than that.
Do you pick lottery numbers?
What'd
I mean,
you
not
say?
That I would ever.
What?
I can't say that up here.
I love the 7 o'clock hour. You got to realize we've been here all day together and on the stage together all day, so there's no telling what could happen.
It's only going to get worse.
We have told you we'd all three come up here and talk about this chart, and I wish we could just keep going because next week I'm going to start a series in Revelation and kind of hoping Jesus comes back between now and next week, but we're going to start that.
That would answer one of the questions.
Yeah, that would answer the question. But, you know, guys, 7 or 8 years ago, as I've told you before, the three of us were doing quite a bit of counseling. That was the early days of Stonegate. And so many people, as they do now, were coming in and dealing with so many issues. And it had kind of gotten to a point, though, where we kept hearing a lot of this. I cannot believe I did this. Sometimes it was followed by, I can't believe I did this again. Why does this issue keep coming up in my life? And we really gathered together in a conference room with these ugly orange chairs and orange carpet that was really great in the 70s and a whiteboard. And we just said, let's see if we can work through this together. As a result, we've been working through it and teaching through it for years now. But all three of us bring something different to it. Mike teaches it in various contexts. I teach it in certain contexts. John very specifically has been using this model through an eating disorders class that has been going on around here and just working through that. But what I wanted us to do was just really be able to, we'll just really talk back and forth about it based on what we've heard and what we've seen and try to remember the highlights of things we've discussed all day today to hopefully bring some more clarity to this and the questions people have had. But just a reminder, as you look at, this is the what we would call the bottom part of the chart. We'll spin this around and deal with the top half a little bit later. But obviously, the bottom half is where we spend so much of our time with folks, and honestly, with ourselves, too. I mean, the truth is, this is where we most naturally spend our time. But just to bring you up to speed, all of us, we didn't write it here on the board, but all of us, if you were to write it on that side, enter every day with some kind of issue, trial, or test, or struggle. And everybody in this room has some type of issue, trial, test, or struggle you're going through. Even if it's very simple, even if it's very small to you, or maybe to someone else, it's very large to you. You might be facing something tomorrow morning that, in my opinion, may seem like quite a trivial issue, but in your life, it's making you nervous. You may not sleep tonight. You might be facing something physically that nobody knows about, and it's a test of trust, whether you're going to trust that God will be faithful and God will be walking with you through this. But at every place that we are tested, and every issue we go through, behind it is always a legitimate need. And for instance, we'll talk about some issues of needing approval. Well, that's a legitimate need to want someone to approve us, but how we get approval is where the problem comes into play. And so what we do is 1 John chapter 2, verse 16 says that I have a distorted desire, and it is walking in the flesh. It's I see, I want, or I think I deserve. And so automatically, and I'll have Mike dive into this a little bit more here in just a minute, when I feel like I need to be affirmed, then I sometimes define how I think I should be affirmed, and I deserve it a certain way, which leads me to try to pursue affirmation in a distorted sort of way. Then I begin defending my pursuit, protecting the way I feel, or blaming other people for not affirming me, which then leads to, and I'm going to have these guys talk about the whole sin issue, sometimes an action or an acting out. Now, what we want to clarify this evening for you is that often we used to have this huge lightning bolt right here that said sin. And we would say that you'd spin around here and then you'd commit the big sin, then come to the office and say, I can't believe I did it. Really, sin begins right here as soon as you decide not to trust God to meet your needs in a certain way that He wants to. But oftentimes we act out of these issues in order to get a false sense of satisfaction. We then defend how we've gone about gaining this satisfaction. Then, and we'll talk a little bit later on about this whole issue of feeling guilty and sorrowful, because whenever we meet a legitimate need illegitimately, especially as a follower of Jesus, that's called sowing to the flesh rather than sowing to the Spirit. And as soon as I reap from the flesh what I have sown to the flesh, then I realize it's not satisfying. And I feel a sense of what the world might call guilt, but as a follower of Jesus Christ, we'll talk about what sorrow is. But then what we find out is the original issue about my need for approval still here, because I haven't found sufficiency in Christ, and now I have a choice to make. I either repent, change my mind and direction, and go to the other side of this chart that we've looked at and we'll look at this morning, or I repeat the whole process again. And what I'll find is if I don't deal with this the way God wants me to deal with it, I'm going to deal with the same issue over and over and over again. So a little bit of review. Mike, I'm going to pass it off to you and let you talk about this whole I issue and all that and whatever else you're thinking about.
All right.
I'll scoot over so I don't crowd
yeah,
you.
Thank you.
Yep.
Sorry. A little further, please.
Okay.
Over there.
Sit on the floor.
Yeah. That X right there. Yeah. One of the things that is interesting is a lot of times when we teach this, and when we used to have the lightning bolt there, it was even more so, is that people identified this chart as only really impacting you if you had a big sin struggle. You had a struggle with a repeated sinful behavior that was real obvious to you. And if somebody is dealing with addiction of any sort, they understand that. And usually they sense this pressure and this burden of wanting to stop behaving in a certain way. And one of the things that I think is so important about this chart and this picture, and something Patrick just mentioned, is really the minute we step into this realm, we've started the sin process. Our issues are not sin. Okay, our issues, our struggles are not necessarily sin. They sometimes are the consequences of sin. They sometimes manifest themselves in sinful behavior, but loneliness is not a sin. And really, even the desire for respect in and of itself is not a sin. Pain, physical pain, is not a sin. But all of these things and how we respond to them can lead us into this cycle. We have a me on Patrick's little guy here. And I like to put, when I teach this, I put a big I there, because most of us don't say, me hungry, or me want respect, or me deserves better from my boss. I mean, some of us do.
Some people do.
That's
I think
a whole
that
other
guy
issue.
Over there does.
What we say, I. And when you have me here, that's what we're talking about. But if you put I, and you think about every time you respond to an issue in your life with beginning the sentence with the word I, then you start to see what you're doing. And that is one of the most valuable parts of this chart. Because the I, a focus that steps out of, here's my struggle, here's my issue, I am going to take control, I am going to deal with this my way, puts you in a place of sin. It puts you in a place of being contrary to what God has called us to do, what Christ calls us to do when we say we're going to follow Him. And we are to die to I. And when we step on this thing, we are doing the opposite of dying to it. We are feeding it. In some ways, we are worshiping it. So we start this process. And for me, I think I see and I want really is encompassed by I deserve. If we think about it, if we see something that we want, we think that we deserve that thing. If we watch a relationship somebody else has, there's something in us that usually says, I see that, I want that, I deserve that. For me personally, and I use this chart. This is not us three holy men standing here teaching you all that we've learned in a world that we don't deal with these things. I use this picture, because I know that when I start slipping into the I deserve, that I am in a position to begin this cycle. The blame. You know what blame is? Blame is when you say, if this were different, then I would not be where I am. I would behave differently if they behave differently. That's just another word for blame. Distorted pursuit, I also talk about, up here, defending and protecting, isolating ourselves, withdrawing, putting up huge walls in relationship so that we don't get hurt again because we don't trust people. All of those things are a part of this cycle of self-focus. And what happens, the lightning bolt has some reality, because we end up doing something. If nothing else, this is sin, but the lightning bolt represents when we realize we've done something. When something comes out of what's going on inside of us internally and begins to expose itself. Sometimes that creates a huge disruption to our world. There are a lot of consequences. People are hurt. Our situation is hurt. You know, let's just say, hypothetically, completely hypothetically, that I'm struggling with my boss at work. This could never happen, of course, because we work at a church.
That's right. And we're all perfect.
But let's just say, hypothetically, that I really desire to be affirmed and appreciated and respected by my boss. And let's just say that, I know this you would never think this would happen, but he says something slightly insensitive. And I begin to think, I don't deserve that. I deserve better than this. He doesn't respect me. He doesn't appreciate me. He doesn't see what I bring to the table.
Because you're too sensitive.
Yeah. I know based on this exterior, you would never expect that I'm a sensitive man. I know that.
But you're just trying to help him with it,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
that's right.
But here's what happens is I start to spin, and what I withdraw, I shut down. You know what happens in meetings then? I get this pinched look on my face, and anything is said can be good or bad, but I'm gonna harden myself to it. And he called me on it years ago one time when he said, it wasn't towards him, but in a meeting one time he said, your humor is turning to cynicism. And you know, for me, the biggest issue I have today is my tongue. You know, so all of a sudden, everything boiling inside of this self-absorption spews out of my mouth in a word, a hurtful word, a stinging word, a sarcastic word. And then I begin the process over here. Sometimes I don't realize that anything's going on until the word comes out of my mouth and it all comes home to me. What's important, I think, about understanding this is starting here. When you start to think that way and to realize, if I don't check this right now, I will begin my process, and I will get to the thing that I regret.
Hey, on that, John, talk about how that's, I was going to say it's nature to us, but as a follower of Jesus, your primary nature, your new creature in Christ, is that you are able to walk in the Spirit. But Paul talks about the flesh warring against the Spirit and the Spirit against the flesh. And you had mentioned in our meeting together that we do this quite naturally and don't even realize. So talk about how quickly we go through these processes, and even what we talked about in the last three services about how we can be going through this process so quickly during the day and it expose itself later on at night.
Well, it's something that, you know, you started when you were born. Because any of you have newborns or been around newborns, you know that those little rascals are so demanding. I mean, they're cute, but they are demanding. None of them ever think about, and you didn't either, you weren't sitting there as a little baby going, you know, I'm going to wait because I know my mom and dad are really tired, and I know I'm hungry and I'm wet, but I'm going to wait till it's a better time for them. So we really grow up with this self-centered approach to life of, you know, I just want what I want, when I want, how I want it. And so we're very practiced at this, and we all develop our own particular style and way of doing that. Some people get quiet. Some people think, like me, that stoplights are only for y'all. I should get the green lights, and the stoplight is unfair because I'm the one that's in a hurry, and I don't care if it makes you late. And Well, anyway. So we live a lifetime doing this, and consequently, as you learn things, the more you practice something, the more automatic it becomes. And so a lot of times people come in, and they don't even realize they've gone through this whole process of it being all about them until they get over here, and they think they just do this. Mm-hmm. You know, you think, I didn't plan it, I just did that. You know, and I don't really even know how I did that. It wasn't a decision that I made, it's just what happens. But the reality is that there's all kinds of cues, because when we talk about the issues that are over here that we all have, usually when something like that comes up, you'll have a feeling. You know, those things that bother us, those feelings, and you'll have a feeling that compels you into this whole realm of acting and thinking until you find yourself over here. So one of the really helpful things for us to do is to begin thinking about, how does all this stuff happen? Slow it down until you can recognize way back here, maybe even if you don't know the issue has been happened, but you know that you have that feeling. Mm-hmm. And you know that that's the sign for you to come in.
Can I add one thing to that real quick? Mm-hmm. This side of the chart, I think this is one of the most different things about this picture. This side of the chart is very culturally accepted. Now, when we hurt someone, when we do something bad, I think even culture says you should pay for something, you should feel bad about something. But this is the gospel according to Oprah. It is. What do you hear when you hear and you watch those shows about women who may be in a bad or unsatisfying marriage? You have a right to be happy. It's encouraged guarding and protecting yourself, taking yourself and your own happiness into your own hands and pursuing that. We oftentimes in the church get sucked into that as well, where we don't see a problem with this. This seems natural, and it even sometimes is affirmed in the church. But what we have to see, and what's so vital to get out of this is the beginning process that leads to that always, even though culture will affirm this. And somebody pointed out to me after the last service an interesting point. When we say, I deserve to be happy, I wish I could tell you how many people have stepped into complete, unquestionable sin, beginning with those words, I deserve to be happy. But what we also do there is we also then kind of usually attribute it to God, that says, I deserve to be happy, and God would not want me to be unhappy. So we put a spiritual spin on our pursuit of self. And that's why it's so important to get this picture in your head, so that when you start down this process, you see that this is not good. This may be what everybody else is telling me to do. Right. But it's not good, and it is not what you read when you dig into Scripture.
Well, the one thing that these guys mentioned in the previous three services was, if you don't check this flesh pattern, when you get to this second half, things start spinning. And Mike used a phrase in the second hour when he said, things start flinging off of you and start hurting people around you. You know, it's sort of like if you get around someone who's, and they go down the highway and some guy's mowing and it says caution, mowing taking place, and you just hope you can get through it and something not fly out from under the lawnmower and break your windshield. And, you know, the enemy is always out to destroy you. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 6, to be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil. Jesus told us he's come to steal and to kill and destroy. Well, to use the example of your homes, your home life, the enemy is going to begin working on the destruction of those closest to you in the very area where you don't believe he's working to destroy you. Here's what I mean by that. When you go to work, or you go to school, or wherever you spend your day, the enemy is going to begin working in the I deserve category very quickly with the people you work with, or the people you go to school with, or your friends. And because someone treats you a certain way, or says something to you, or doesn't say something to you, then by 8:45 in the morning, on Monday morning, you've immediately started a cycle of I deserve better than this at school or at work or wherever you're spending your day. And you start a process of blaming people for what's happening in your life and protecting yourself and putting up walls of defense. What you don't realize is the enemy is not nearly as concerned about destroying your work environment as he is planting bitterness inside of you to destroy the people closest to you in your relationships, which in your life are your family and perhaps your friends. And so here's what happens to all of us. We come home, and the enemy has been winning a battle because we have not put on the full armor of God, as Ephesians 6 talks about. We haven't checked the flesh to begin walking in the Spirit, which is really where we belong, where we should be walking. And all along, we've been spinning down here because we've also compartmentalized family and church and work and not realized the enemy's working in that environment. So he's spinning us out of control here in a very culturally affirmed way. Well, I should be getting treated better than this and so on and so forth. And we're not dying to ourselves. And we really, our actions at work have been maybe cold or calculated or deceptive or hurtful towards others. But all the while, the enemy has just been preparing us for our wife and children to say something or not say something or not do something at home where he's going to do his most destructive work. And if you haven't been paying attention, as the enemy has been sowing in you this deep seed of I deserve better, you think you're coming home to a neutral environment. And what the enemy's getting ready to do is sow into your life the fact that you walk in the front door and no one gave you the respect you deserved. And someone said something in a way you had already calculated it was not supposed to be said. And so by 7 o'clock in the evening, you have already either sarcastically or quite intentionally destroyed every living human being in your household. And you've even gone to bed that night and you've said to your spouse or you've said to yourself, why did I just destroy my son's dreams like that? Why did I just humiliate my wife like that? Why is my whole family shut down tonight and I'm watching TV alone or whatever? Because the enemy is out to destroy. And he's using processes that sometimes we have not even noticed have happened. And the next thing you know, we're still facing some anger issues or some deserving issues. And we have to go back and confess to our families and stuff. And we just spin this stuff and it destroys people in our families.
Or a lot of times what we'll do is whenever you find yourself thinking that you have acted badly, but it's understandable because of how everyone else did, you know you're there.
Right.
Okay. And the other thing, though, that happens is that we, in families particularly, and in marriages, we reciprocate all this. Does it make sense? So I will come home, and I'll be maybe less than kind to my wife, and she may respond less than kind to me, which justifies me not being kind back to her. Do you understand how that works? Y'all probably never have.
Because nobody keeps score but you.
Yes. Probably so.
Let me move on to this issue so we can flip this deal.
Okay.
Most of us know something or sometime in our lives where we get to it and we go, I just can't believe I did that. And don't make it the big, you know, we have our categories of sins in the church. We have the big sins that you haven't done yet. And then there's our little sins that we deal with and our family knows about. You understand what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
And we do that. And then we've all prayed this prayer. We've all prayed in some form or another, God, I hate it that I do that, and I just promise you, God, I'm not going to do that again. Tomorrow I'm going to walk in the Spirit. And we just, and if we're not careful, as a follower of Jesus, you will slip into a feeling of guilt. And then what we do is we slip into a pattern of religion until we feel like God accepts us based on religious terms. Well, for the follower of Jesus Christ, 2 Corinthians chapter 7 talks about godly sorrow that leads to repentance. You know, when your children do something in your home or someone you love does something to you that hurts you or hurts the relationship, if you truly love them, your intention is not to pile guilt on them, but to welcome them back into the relationship. And when you're, as a Christ follower, the Bible says really what you're going through as a result of sin is the sorrow that comes from a broken relationship. You know, when 1 John chapter 1, verse 9 says, if we confess our sins or say about our sins what God says, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He is not faithful and just to you. He is faithful and just to himself and what he did on the cross. To forgive you. And to forgive literally means to, as if it never happened, let it go. And so what happens is you and I go through this godly sorrow, and we will do one of two things. You will either believe that God has a greater joy planned for you than you do for yourself, and you will repent and go to the flip side of this chart, or you will not trust in the adequate foundation of Jesus to be able to be a satisfactory or meet your needs in a satisfactory manner, and you go right back down to repetition and right back to work the next day and say, I deserve better. But If you choose, you know what, God, I want to walk in the joy you have for me. That means you're saying, I want to walk back into the very circumstance that's driving me crazy, and I want to see what you want to do, God. And that's what sort of brings us, let's do our little turn the board thing here. And I'm going to let Mike sort of take you through the first part of this and bring you to this waiting issue. So,
Patrick just hit something big. A lot of times when we get to that place where we have a momentary desire to change or to take something to God. A lot of times, I think that's based on our circumstances because we are equating our struggle or our issues with our circumstances. And so I kept thinking, you know, how many times do people get frustrated at work and frustrated at work and frustrated at work and then quit and go to a new job and they think they have fixed it because they have a new job. But all that happens in the new job is they don't respect them there and they don't respect them there. They do the same thing with relationships. Unfortunately, we go through marriages and relationships as easily as we go through jobs half the time. But we haven't dealt with the thing. So we move up to this place, sometimes for a moment.
Hey, wait, time out.
Because we are desperate.
Before you jump off into that, back up a little bit on what you just said about relationships, because we've said it in all three, and we just about missed it on this one, in that if you've come out of a bad relationship, and you're spinning in that first part about I deserve a better relationship, and then you decide to start going back to church and following Jesus, and because you think at church is a better place to find someone following Jesus than Graham's, and so you come to church and you meet someone. What'd you say?
They went out of business.
Graham's Pharmacy?
Yeah, exactly. Chocolate shake. And so you come to church and you meet someone who has been through the same issues and hardships you've been through, mm-hmm. same relationship struggles you've been through, and all of you you're spinning in the same place together. And the problem is you're still spinning in what you called Oprah theology. I deserve better, and I'm going to start pursuing Jesus. And then you latch on to someone, you're thinking, this is the greatest relationship. And rather than being content, and we'll talk about this loneliness issue later, you find someone that's just, you guys are just so alike. You've both been hurt in similar ways, and it brings you together. And what you're doing is you're not pursuing Jesus. You're spinning in what you think you deserve. You run into somebody else spinning in what they think they deserve. And then you come together and you do this great marriage. And then you wake up one day and you find out, I didn't deserve this. Mm-hmm. And because you stepped right out of your same issue you needed to deal with into the same issue you needed to deal with in a relationship.
And people who come together thinking that they deserve to be happy are not going to
be
make
happy.
Each other happy. It doesn't work that way.
And
they're both worried about themselves.
And can I say this one thing is that if you find yourself in that situation right now, when you come into this new relationship, you will only see what is different. It's a little bit like standing on Interstate 20 and saying, well, that truck is blue. The one that ran over me last time was red. So this is a lot different.
Right, that's right.
You know, but you still get run over. So if you only attend, if you find yourself in that situation, you will tend to only look at what is different. Please don't do that.
And you will only find the people who agree with you in guarding and protecting and defending. And we joked about it, but you will, you know, you will Facebook and say, I deserve to be happy, and this is what I deserve. And everybody will be like, I like that, man. And then so... And then, you know,
I like that.
And if someone dares say to you, you know, I think God may have a different plan, they're like, defriend.
Yeah,
I mean,
like
you're
that.
Out. I mean, and that's because it's this. So, anyways, I'm
but
sorry.
It's funny if you look at Facebook, like people will be like, my work is terrible. Nobody respects me. Everything's bad in my life. And then you'll be like, four people like this.
Yeah, everyone likes that.
Like, what?
And they all go to Stonegate.
Yeah.
I love this church. Everyone agrees with church.
I always look like, who in the heck likes this? I mean, let's be bitter. The thing is that anytime that spiritual maturity is not never finding yourself on that bottom eight, that bottom loop. Spiritual maturity is catching yourself earlier and earlier as you grow and grow. And you can pull you do not have to take it. Because many of you are sitting out there going, looking at the person next to you going, okay, you're that person he just talked about. You can always right the ship. You know, you can spin back off anytime up to this place of seeking the Lord. What happens is a lot of times, remember we talked about this process, pray. I also really like to make sure we add seek the Lord through his word there. Because Patrick had an amazing definition of wisdom, seeking God's perspective for your issue. And the only way we're really going to know God's perspective is in relationship with him. The only way we're in relationship with him is not primarily by talking to him, but also listening to him. And the best way to listen to him is through his word. And so that's part of it. And then as we do that, we die to ourselves and we learn to trust him. What happens for a lot of us is we jump in here and we do this for a minute in desperation. A minute, a day, a week, a month. And all of it, but really, we're not seeking the Lord. We're not dying to ourselves. We're presenting our circumstances to him for him to change our circumstances. And when our circumstances don't change like we would like them to within our time frame, we bail.
Because we don't really think he knows our circumstances.
Right.
And knows our issue.
Well, we're not sure we can really trust him because our idea of what satisfaction will be is different.
And I think one of the things, sort of like on the bottom, when it's so important to sort of be able to chart your responses so that you can see where you're going, another thing that I think is really important up here is figuring out what are the enemies to me staying in this process, because there is a lot of stuff out there conspiring against this process. I think fear or lack of trust is what we've been talking about. I don't know what God is going to do. I don't trust him to do something other than what I specifically want him to do. And so at some point we start to feel a little out of control and we wrestle, or we think we are. We think we're pulling control back from God and we slip back to that bottom. Mm-hmm. Waiting is not popular. We don't wait for popcorn. We certainly aren't going to wait months and months and years and maybe even a lifetime in the middle of a struggle from culture. Culture does not help that. The church oftentimes does not help that. People can be the greatest blessing in the wait, and they can be the greatest hindrance in the wait, and both of those groups of people can be sitting in this room with you. The people that encourage you, you know what? What are you doing sitting there? What are you waiting for? You deserve to be happy. Do something. We hear that all the time from well-meaning friends, and we have to be careful with that. And then a good friend can really help you, not necessarily by fixing your situation, which is what a lot of codependent-type friends want to do with well-meaning, but just being there with you and encouraging you as you sit in the wait. I told Patrick when we were talking about this weeks ago as he was preaching through it, I think that the wait is inherently lonely. There is an absolute loneliness that is almost always a part of the wait, for sure. And sometimes there's a deep loneliness that resides through the entire wait. Let me tell you why I think that is so real and important. So much of what fuels our bad and destructive behavior is a desire for someone to be something to us, to receive something from someone, whether that's encouragement, whether that's love, whether that's affection, whether that's attention, whether that's affirmation. And I believe that part of this process, part of it is me saying, I'm giving you me. I'm giving you all of me. And we don't do that very easily. And so God takes us through seasons of loneliness. Loneliness is the single biggest factor that thrusts people out of this upward cycle. Because if you, and I think probably more people than we realize struggle with some form of loneliness. I think the popularity of Facebook is a testimony to the loneliness of our culture. A deep desire for some form of connection. A deep desire to be loved and accepted and affirmed. As Christians, we know in our heads that the greatest love we can receive and the most perfect affirmation we can get is God's affirmation of us. But our flesh yearns for something from other people, so God takes us through a wait to take us away from that dire, unhealthy need for something from another person that God never intended the other person to supply to us. I just shared this story. When I was starting my real journey through some difficult issues about 15 years ago, I was incredibly lonely. And I was reading lots of books about how to get over my struggle. And a lot of them said I needed to find some good, healthy male friendship. So I went to community Bible study, which was a great Bible study. And I thought, I'm going to go to this Bible study because there are good Christian men there who are going to be my friends, and they are going to fix this problem for me. And I walked in there probably with a million things in front of me that said, do not talk to me. And apparently all of those things worked because very few people really talked to me. But I went in there to that Bible study with the desire to make good friends so that my situation would be repaired. And I got frustrated, and I remember one night getting frustrated with God and saying, I'm quitting that stupid Bible study. And in my heart, you know, not audible words, but in my heart, I felt like God said, go to the Bible study to meet me. And I realized I'm seeking spiritual things with ulterior motives, and I began to change my perspective on that Bible study. And I began to go to that Bible study with no desire other than to connect with God through His Word. And slowly but surely, I began to have a relationship with God. Not just my Savior from hell, but I began, you know what happens when we do all this? We begin to accept and receive who He says we are and His affirmation of us. And then over time, all of a sudden I realized I was enjoying the company of the men in this Bible study. And then years later, I developed friendships like I have with these two guys that were that lifeblood friendship for me that I had always desired. But I realized, God, if God had given me the friends I wanted back then, I would have sucked the life out of them to be everything I desired them to be. It would have been unhealthy for me, and it would have been unhealthy for them. But He took me through a period, a long, intense period of loneliness, and I'm a real relational guy, so I still battle loneliness sometimes. But He took me through this battle and this weight of loneliness, and I think He does that with you. He is not going to give you a substitute for Himself.
That's right.
For you to latch on to. And we as Christ followers, sometimes we want to jump in and rescue everybody, but all we really are called to do is walk alongside of them. Because if we jump in to try to rescue them, we may be enabling the problem that got them there in the first place. So I think that's such an important part of this process, and I just want to acknowledge it because we look at loneliness as very weak, and nobody ever wants to say they're lonely. It feels kind of pathetic. But it's a huge reality for so many people, a deep loneliness that oftentimes is masking what is really there, which is a deep desire to be loved and appreciated by men. And God will strip that so that we realize, I don't need friends. I have all I need in God. He blesses me with friends. They are the whipped cream on top of my relationship. I'm a savory, so it's the gravy. Gravy, it's something special and added. It is not the source of my life. And He will take us through that. And almost everybody, I think, in their issues has to go through that.
Because that my issues, we've said before, my issue is not my issue.
That's right.
And my circumstance is not my issue.
My desire for Patrick to affirm me at the office, is never going to be solved, no matter how many times he affirms me at the office.
Which is a lot. I mean, it's a lot.
If he ever affirms me at the office, it won't help.
What in the world?
You affirm all of us a lot.
But the reality is, if I think that's my problem, if I think my wife doing something special for me every day is going to fix it, I'm missing the deeper issue. I'll just need more from her. I will just need more from him. I'll just need more until I realize I am not defined by how they talk to me, how they treat me. My identity is in Christ alone. And when my identity is secure, and I really think that's a huge lifelong journey for every one of us, growing in that understanding, I am not defined by how much you all like me and how much anybody does for me, how much satisfaction I get. We will just bump up the need. If we get what we're looking for and we don't realize I really need something else, I really need to know that I'm okay with God.
That's why God will keep you in this place of waiting in your particular circumstance as long as it takes to keep you dependent, because His objective is not to make me independent, it's to make me blessedly dependent.
Absolutely.
So that out of that dependence, I can then minister to somebody else. And it drives us to this issue right here. These guys have corrected me multiple times on this when they've said, well, really, you should put the word is here. And then discover, because through this whole process, what God is trying to lead you to is a discovery of the sufficiency of Jesus. And He's not going to use so much of your religious practice to discover that as much as He is the process of your testing and trial to lead you to a place that you discover Christ is ultimately sufficient for you. And you discover that portion by portion, moment by moment. You don't discover the sufficiency of Christ completely on this Sunday. You discover it for the need of the moment. And then he prepares you through that process. And I love the way this whole process runs through, where really it's not a place of arrival, but it's a place of change and growth. And we talked about in the last service how if this is my issue, if this whiteboard represents my current struggle, and we also talked about how every issue you're going through is going to change your life if you allow Christ to change you through it. But ultimately, the reason he's working change in your life, according to 2 Corinthians 1, is so you can then be used to minister comfort to others who go through the same thing. You're not being changed for your benefit. You're actually being changed for the benefit of others. And so if I go through this process and I resist the flesh because of the Spirit and die to myself and see God work through this process and go through whatever the season of waiting is, and my circumstance may never change. Maybe my health doesn't get better. Use that as a situation. But I find out that Christ is sufficient. Then rather than arriving somewhere, there's a part of me that has grown. And then what's immediately going to happen next on this side is I'm going to encounter what?
Another issue.
Another issue. Another test and another trial. And now that test or trial might be represented by this chair. Okay, so I've grown here, and I am growing, as Paul says in Galatians, Christ is being formed in me. Now I face another issue, and it's got me to a place of having to trust the foundation of Jesus Christ, which is faith, and believe that he is sufficient. But this one hits me a little different way, and I happen to not crucify the flesh that day, and I go to the backside of this deal. And if I don't deal with it, I just start spinning around here like we've been talking about, and I gather around people around me who think I should rightfully spin, and what God's going to do is this situation will not change because God has a character issue he wants to change in my life. What it literally is he wants to work through you and through me the fruit of the Spirit. You talked about that, John, in the last three services. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. What God is doing is working through you to manifest his character of love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, kindness, gentleness, self-control. That's his greater purpose. So he's brought a trial or a test into my life to show his sufficiency for him to be exalted so more people see love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. Against such thing there is no law. So while I may be able to minister to people who are going through this issue that I've gone through, there's another issue he wants me to minister into people's lives. But before I can touch their lives in that issue, he wants to work that through me as well. You guys want to add anything to that?
Well, I think just to say that you will, if you walk in the Spirit, which is what we're talking about here, you will have the fruit of the Spirit. In the same way as if I am completely consumed with myself, I will act in a very self-centered way and eventually really mess up.
And you'll reap to the flesh, as the Bible says,
exactly.
Instead of reaping to the Spirit.
And so, you know, it's not like I'm going to be patient. It's okay, God, I got to trust you that you know what's the most important thing here.
Right. Hey, Mike, talk about the refining.
Yeah.
And what that looks like, and then we'll have to wrap
it
up.
I think, too, if we are so circumstance-driven, but if we're Christ followers, and you look at these words, I think that, I know that sometimes my circumstances and my situations can seem so extreme, but when I get deep into myself, and I think of what it would be like for me to walk in a way that Christ is exalted out of my life, and Christ is proven sufficient for me, and Christ is formed in me, my circumstances become less important, because this is the life that you are experiencing, that fruit of the Spirit. And no matter how bad our situations are, if we had love, joy, peace, patience, kindness in the midst of them, we wouldn't care about them. And I think my counselor said one time, I love the visual. The other one is spinning, you never move. I love the visual that you're moving a little bit. You're making progress towards, like Paul said in Philippians, onward. I'm moving towards the goal. But God, if he dumped everything on you at the moment of your salvation, very few of us would be ready or able to handle it. And so what happens as we grow is, I remember my counselor saying, I didn't want to talk about something. And he said, well, God's going to bring that up again. And sure enough, 8 years later, he did. But I remember thinking, what in the world would have happened if I had really tried to deal with this 8 years ago? I would have collapsed because I have grown and I was strengthened. I love the visual in God's word that's repeated over and over again of this, of being refined, of the refiner's fire. And sometimes we can read that and it sounds kind of churchy, but if you think about gold or silver, we live out here and we have oil and gas, and you think about, we are a lump as Christ followers of precious gold, of great value. But we are full of things that God wants to bring to the surface. And you know, gold is refined through what? Heat, fire. I love Hebrews 12, this picture of God's discipline or his training of us. And it says all discipline is sorrowful for the moment. And I think the heat getting turned up is painful. But what happens is that the impurities rise to the surface. And the refiner deals with those impurities. And then, you know what happens again? The heat is turned up more and more rises to the surface. And if we run from that heat, all of that junk in us just sets. We get hard again. All that junk goes nowhere. But it's the heat that moves it and rises it to the surface. And the refiner always is looking into that gold or silver to see his reflection. And with each process of refinement, the reflection becomes clear. And I know that there have been times in my life when that has been the thing that kept me up here. Because I had this visual of God turning up the heat in my life and it being painful, but this picture of him looking into me and his reflection in me getting clearer. And the idea that as I go through the junk in my life, and we all know people whose worlds are crushed who just reflect Christ beautifully. And it's like as we go through those processes, the reflection becomes clearer to the world. And you know when his face is going to be perfectly clear in us? When we meet him in heaven. But every step of the way provides an opportunity for us to experience these things more. And I know that sometimes we get bogged down, but if you think about the thought of Christ being exalted out of you, I hope that inspires something in you. I hope it fires something up. This is hope. Hope is not a new job. Hope is not a new relationship. Hope is not more money. This is hope. God says in the writer in Hebrews says that God disciplines us so that we can share in his holiness, but also so that we will bear the peaceful fruit of righteousness. And that's a beautiful reason to surrender to this.
That's right.
The thought of bearing the peaceful fruit of righteousness.
That's right.
I really think that is a definition of hope. You know, it's not just getting out of hell. That is where abundance here on earth comes from, in that picture of bearing the peaceful fruit of righteousness.
That's awesome. John, would you pray for us?
Absolutely.
Just pray us out of here.
Lord God, we thank you so much that you're sovereign and that you care and that you watch over our lives. We thank you, Father, that you give us hope, that you give us your spirit, the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in us, and that you promise that you will work with us, that you will work until your work is complete in us. But Father, I just ask that for each person here and for myself, that we would look at the issues that come up, the opportunities that draw us into this self-centered life would be seen by us, that your spirit would point that out to us early, and that we would yield to you, and that we would submit to you, that we would seek you, that you would give us the wisdom to know that you are actively changing us. We thank you for that. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Have a great evening. Thanks for being here, and thanks for sitting in the middle.